What are the three states in the cycle of time? Past. Past, then?
Present.
Present, then? Right? Okay. So right now, technically, where are we?
In the present.
I think so. So my drawing skills, as you see, are the way they are. Just adjust, okay? This is you. You'll be happy, you're much more beautiful than this. So we are right now in the so-called present moment, isn't it? Now, I have to ask you one question. Right now, whoever you're being in the present, when I'm saying being in the present, your mood, your experience, the way you are experiencing whatever is happening in life, right?
Life is happening continuously,
yes? Is life a continuous happening? Something or the other is happening with me every time, every minute. Whatever is that happening, that is life, isn't it? One moment it could be eating, drinking, walking, sleeping, whatever. So as life is happening, each of us is experiencing life. Am I right? Now, whatever is the way you look at life, whatever is the experience you have about life, that's happening technically in the present moment. Is that right?
Yes.
Is that right? Are you living in yesterday?
No.
No. Are you living in tomorrow?
No.
No. You're living now. Isn't it? Where is life? Now. 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 The moment this now moves, you move to the next moment. There, then you're living there. You're no more in the past anymore. Technically, right? Now if I have to ask you, what is it that makes you who you are today? Right now, what you are? Yes, what is it?
The sum total of all your experiences.
Absolutely, the sum total of all your experiences. Isn't that so? What else? My experiences. What else? What else gives me who I am right now in my life? At this point in time, I'm something in life, right? What are the things, that the factors that contribute to that? One is your experiences. What else?
Whatever we wish,
you're saying. Our wishes, okay? Then what else? Yeah, our expectations and all that. What else?
Genetics,
okay. My genetics. Then? Also your upbringing, isn't it? Yes or no?
Oh, yeah.
The way I'm brought up is so important, yes?
Yes.
When I'm brought and brought up in a particular community, in a particular family, in a particular religion, in a particular culture, in a particular country, I'm different from another culture, country, religion. Yes or no?
Yes.
Christians are a particular way, Hindus are a particular way, Muslims are a particular way, isn't it? So, upbringing. What else? What else? What else makes you who you are? Huh? Correct. Social and religious patterns, in which my social religious patterns. What else?
Surroundings.
Surroundings. Great. What else?
Climate.
What else?
Our interpretation.
Absolutely. My interpretations. Yes. What else? Can I say education?
Yes.
Doesn't education contribute to who I am? If I'm a scientist, I behave differently. If I'm a lawyer, if I'm a doctor. That's how we think, isn't it? Aren't we different depending upon our educational, academic backgrounds?
Yeah.
Yes or no? Then?
Your economic background.
Yeah, my economic background, my occupation. Of course, my gender, then? Occupation, and so on and so forth. So many things. Now, can I collectively call this entire whole realm as past? Can I say past? Can I say that? Because any of that belongs to the past or belongs to now? Isn't it? It's a combination of a whole collection of my past. Yes or no?
Yes.
My education, upbringing, my culture, anything is what? Is coming from where? Is coming from my past. Are we getting this? So usually what we think about life, what we think about the way we are, who we are and the way we are and the way we behave and the way we experience life is what? That I live my life because of my past. My past gives me who I am in the present moment, in the now. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, I'm going to make a couple of radical statements. What are radical statements? Statements which will not be logical. They'll fly in the face of logic. Means you may not be able to accept them easily. I'll make a couple of radical statements. If you have questions, I request you to keep it till the end of this whole thing. Let the whole conversation unfold. Then I'll ask, if you have questions, you can ask me. I want you to listen first. Now, the moment you listen, what thought will you get? How can that be? Because what I'm going to say is not logical, remember. It's radical. Do we get this? So the first statement I want to share with you is that your past, whatever you consider, your upbringing, everything, whatever the collection of your past has got nothing, zero, zilch, to do with who you are in the present moment. Your past has got nothing to do with who you are being, what you are experiencing in the present moment. That's the first statement. It's a statement I'm making. We'll see how and why. Now, if my past has got nothing to do with who I am in the present, then what do you think is giving me my experience in the present moment?
Your mind. Interpretation.
But what do you think? I'm asking in terms of this cycle. The cycle of time, what is it that gives you who you are being or the experience you're generating from life moment by moment? What gives me who I'm being in my present moment is the future that I am living into. My present is not a function of my past as I usually think. We always curse our past. Why did I have that childhood? Why did I have that father who had to beat me? Why did I have that brother who actually molested me and abused me? Why did I have that teacher who just ripped me in the class that day? Why did I have to go to sciences? Why did I not go to math? We think our whole life actually is a result of the past. But no. Our life, the experience of our life every moment is not because of a past moment but because of the future moment that I am living into. Now, how do I substantiate this? I'll give you examples. Yes. What is your favorite holiday spot?
Favorite holiday spot? I would say there's a spot in Tobago.
In where?
Tobago.
Tobago?
Yeah.
Which place is that? In Europe?
No, that's a place in my country, sir.
Which country?
Trinidad and Tobago.
Trinidad. Okay. Oh, okay.
Because it's Trinidad and Tobago. Tobago.
It's an island.
Yeah.
Tobago. Okay, great. Are you working?
Not right now, no.
Okay, but you were working at some point in time.
Yeah. Hmm?
Okay, let's consider you're working now. Example. Hmm? So here is Riyas. He's working. Well, which firm were you working for?
I'm an IT professional.
IT professional. Ideal. Good. So let's say you're working, you're an IT professional. Hmm? You work like really, really long and hard hours, as it is the case for me. Right, isn't it? So you're also like that. One of the slogging persons, slogging through work. And it's a Friday evening. Typically, you leave Friday, you wind up by 4 o'clock. So the whole office is gone. But here you are, 8:30 in the night, you're still doing work. Because you have backlog. It's a weekend.
Okay.
And you had to go. You had to go to some place else, enjoy the evening, a Friday evening, so precious. But here you are sitting in the office, slogging out all those files. You still have emails to finish. You still have some pending queues, all that. How would you be?
Frustrated,
right? I'm like, oh God, still so much to go. Oh, this doesn't get over at all, right?
Yeah.
Now your boss is calling you into his cabin. You get in and he says, Riyas, fantastic job done. You know, last 3 months you were the best employee of the firm. So, we are going to give you a reward. And out comes two tickets. Okay. So, let's say, they say, here's a ticket for you and your girlfriend. I don't know if you have one. We can create one just for the exercise. If that's okay with you, I'll take your permission. So, here's it for you and your partner, right?
Right.
And it's taking you to Tobago?
Right.
Tobago. How would you be?
I'll be happy.
Absolutely. You'll be jumping, oh God, what is this? Unbelievable, right? It's like, oh my God. And you're coming out with the tickets in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
And how would you be doing the work now? All your boss says is just give it over. Go, give it over, you know? Give it to your other colleague and just push off now because tomorrow early morning flight you'll have to leave.
Right.
So how would you be?
Ecstatic.
Absolutely ecstatic, isn't it?
Yes.
Elated, happy. Oh gosh, what a beautiful break and what a time. And you're already into that, right? Into that experience of being in Tobago with her.
Right.
And enjoying that whole experience. Now actually, physically, where are you in the present moment?
In the
present moment, he's in the office. He's amidst work. He has piles of work. He has phone calls. All that is there. But who he is being, his experience of that particular situation in life is what? One of high energy, elation, joy. Why? Because future called Tobago is calling him. A future moment that he is living into is already giving the experience of the present moment for him. You get this?
Yes.
Right now some days have passed. You have like a holiday. It's a paid off, by the way. Uh-huh. And a vacation of a week. Now fast forward. Now you are in Tobago. You're actually with her, like strolling hand in hand, sipping that hot cup of coffee. The sun is setting. The waves are just doing a lullaby. Smooth breeze is touching you. And the waves are hitting your legs. Soft sand under your feet. And you both are rosily walking and walking and just lost in the beauty of nature. Right? You're sipping from the same coffee cup. Beyond that, I won't describe. You're doing all that you could have ever done and more. And your cell phone rings. As you're picking up the phone, out from your pocket comes two tickets. The next day morning, you're back to your office. The flight which takes you back to Trinidad.
Right.
How would you be?
Upset.
Absolutely. You're like, oh God, why do holidays get over so soon? If you've ever wondered, I've always wondered all my life. Till like, of course, joined the Arafita once I came to Swami, it's holiday, only holiday. But till then, I would always wonder, why do holidays get over so soon, right? Oh my God, it's over. Do you see actually physically where you are? You're in your favorite holiday destination spot with the favorite person, with a beautiful experience. But what is the experience you're having right now? Is an experience of dullness, maybe depression, maybe feeling sad or sorrow or that shrinking feeling. Why? Why? Because a future moment called back to office, back to work, back to the same old life gives my experience in the present. Is everybody getting this? So life, wherever I am, is always about future that I am getting into and not because of some past. Are you with me till now? Yes? Thank you so much. Let's acknowledge him. Thank you. Any moment you take, every moment you take, you will see that moment is essentially always given by the future moment you are living into. The experience is always given by future moment you are living into. How many times Friday afternoon you are super excited and thrilled? Tell me. Why? Because you know, especially if it is a Monday which is a holiday. Or for that matter Thursday afternoon before Good Friday. Is probably one of the best days of the year, isn't it? Why? Long weekend. No. You have a Friday, you have a Saturday, you have a Sunday. Three full days. Now Sunday night I won't even ask you how you will be feeling. By Sunday evening, you're already low. Thursday evening, you take a drink in elation. Take down that peg. Yaar, 3 days you have, boss. Sunday evening, the same peg, you'll take a depression. Scripted office is starting tomorrow. Back to work, full week I have to work now. Why? Because always my present moment is given by the future I'm living into. The same peg, the same whiskey, the same beer, cup of beer has different connotations on a Thursday afternoon and on a Sunday night. Yes or no?
Yes.
Because the you, who you are being in both situations is a totally different person. Do you get that? How excited you will be on your first night, tell me, on your first day. And what happens after that? Once that is done, I need not tell you, you know what it is. So always it is because of a future moment that I am living into that my present moment is given by. Now if that is the thing, if it actually now logically fits you, fits my understanding, then how come we always think that the past is giving my present? We always, the moment we think of who I am, why am I like this, always we by default go back and go to a past moment and say, oh God, because past has been this way. Why do we think like that? It's because the past is not sitting in the past. Where is it sitting? Yes, the past is unfortunately sitting in your future. Coloring, fencing, constraining your future. How do I say this? Let's go back. When you were born, how were you born? Whole, complete, perfect. You didn't have any limitations about life, right? That was the only time in life when you, by the way, laughed to your best capacity and you were completely self-expressive. You can't see a child who is shrinking. A child is always like a flower, blossoming, booming. Touching the roof. If you had a bunch of children here, they'll be touching the roof. In darshan, the 3 kids can touch the roof in just that half an hour that you sit in silence, they can't sit. There's so much of life they bring in. Last year we had 40 children. You can imagine what happened to me. We were literally doing a somersault circus every night. One sits quiet, wee, the other will start. By the time I go to wee, another will start. No, I mean, they are just that. They just bounce with life. They're full of life. Now you and me were like that. And you were growing up like that. Maybe shouting, jumping, completely, you know, just out in the air, loose and beautiful. And as you were jumping like that one afternoon, what happened? Suddenly, somebody was there, a guest was there in your house, and he said, "Shut up, you brat. Why are you shouting like this and disturbing? Get out. Don't make this noise." What happens to you? Now you're all of two or three and you're just staring into that guy's eyes. Big eyes, he looks like literally Malakshasa one devil staring down at you. Something happened in the past, right? What do you think you would do at that moment? What would be one of your reactions to that situation? That maybe I should never shout on top of my voice when I have big people around me. Now where do you think you'll keep that decision? Right into the future. You already made the decision, parked it here. Now from that time onwards, when you have elders, especially bald people around you, will you shout? You will not. Why? Because already that piece of your past is sitting there. The impact, the consequence, the decision from that piece of your past is already in your future. Do you understand this? So that piece is seen. So rest of your life you will see, you will always have the fear of authority maybe. I'm saying that's one way of reacting. The child can react in many other ways. I'm just giving you an example. Clear? Now you've grown a little bit more. Now Neil has grown a little more big. When I say Neil, you replace yourself with that. All of us, it's the same journey by the way. He's grown a little more big. Going to school. In the school, teacher asks, who was the first, or let's take a more common example. How many continents do we have in the world? And Neil is like, me, I want to tell, I know the answer. Teacher says, yes, Neil, tell me. He says, 10 continents. Everyone laughs. wrong answer. So, now the moment everyone laughs, what happens to little Neil? Something happened in the past, right? What do you think he would say to himself? He would say, idiot, big fellow. You went and put your hand up. You didn't know the answer. Big pudding. Keep your hand down. Never ever be the first person to raise your hand. No. See, everyone is laughing at you. Is there a possibility he could say that?
Yes.
So, where does the decision go? Right into the future. Now that was when he was in 6th class, maybe 10 years or 12 years old. Now he is 22 years old. He's sitting in an office. He's sitting in his boss's cabin. There is a brainstorming session going on, some business problem and a solution has to come out. Now Neil has the solution, but will he raise his hand? No. Why? Because that part of his future is already sealed with a piece of the past and he will instead tell his neighbor, hey, Riyas, you tell, this is the answer, you tell, really. Now Riyas says, I have the answer, Riyas tells the answer, who gets the credit? Riyas gets the credit and Neil loses an opportunity. Do we understand this? So this is how constraints happen. Now Neil has grown a little bit more from that 6th class, 7th class. Neil is now sweet 16. What happens at sweet 16? He is actually looking at a girl. She is also looking at him. He is so excited, thrilled. Oh God, I think something is there. Oh God. He is all blushing. And after many months of secretly looking at her and confirming, she is also looking back at him. What does he decide? I am going to propose. February 14th, best day of the year, Valentine's, goes with one rose. He goes around the city, 2000 shops for one rose, finally finds the rose, takes it in his best attire, best of smiles, goes, stands and says, will you be my Valentine? And he has practiced some 10,000 times to say the Han dialogue. And all that he gets is, monkey, look at your face in the mirror first, then talk to me, go. And she goes in. Now my God, lot of things have happened. What do you think Neil may say? Do you need to guess this? Neil may say 1000 things. Girls are bad, girls are cheaters, girls are mean. Yes or no? Girls are arrogant. Whatever that is about girls. Isn't it? Now this was when he was 16, now he's 26. Married to the best girl in the world. But one hand, one leg will be out of the bedroom with the suitcase, ready to run away. Why? I know. The moment she spills little coffee, I know girls are mean, girls are bad, girls are rude, girls are arrogant, the whole thing, and I'm out of the marriage. This girl is bad. Second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. After the 10th girl, you realize the first girl was the best. But your life is Govinda, Govinda, gone. Gone with 10 relationships in and out. Neil, it's not you, it's an example, Neil. Sorry. So, do we get this? So, in past, continuously when situations are happening in the past, what do? You keep posting the decisions, keep making their impact where? In the future. No wonder, after some time, maybe after 14, nowadays not even that much. Children grow faster than that. The moment I mature into adulthood, do I live anymore? I am no more living. I only have a past living instead of me. So life becomes repetitive. Life is just a repetition of what happened, because I am no more in the zone of having a space for myself. My future is totally colored with impressions from past incomplete incidents. Are we getting this? So though in the present technically I am always getting into the future, which gives me what I am in the present moment, it looks like the past is ruling me, because the past is sitting where? Past is sitting in the future. It's like there are three drawers, past, present, future, and you have files. Past files should go into the past, right? But human beings make a fundamental filing error. We take the past files and put it into the future drawer. And therefore, we don't have any future left. What do we have left? Only past. We are living past, more of past, more of past. The more you live, the more your past is living. So therefore, the more and more I live, the more and more life becomes boring. I am no more as excited as I was when I was a child. Why? Because there is no future there. There is only a complete, fully governed past. Are we understanding this? A small, quick joke. If you are feeling sleepy, you wake up. It's an adult joke. Don't miss it. Wake up, wake up. So, there is a seminar happening. A seminar on sex and intimacy. Now, this professor is an expert. Scientist in that area, obviously goes without saying, has done intense personal research and research on others in the field of sex and intimacy. And he is giving a lecture and he is telling the number of times a human being indulges in sex directly impacts his vitality and health and energy. Let me show you a sample. Let me test it. How many in this room have sex twice a day? Raise your hand. Now, some of them raise their hand. He says, see. They are glowing. Can you see that? You don't need a light there. Automatically their faces are glowing. See? Then he goes to the count. How many times have once a day? And some of them raise. How many times, how many of you have sex once a week? How many of you have sex twice in a week and once in 2 weeks? All the different counts. Then he comes to a point where he says, how many of you have sex at least once in 6 months? And some people raise. See. How dead they are. Do you see? Is there any life where they are? They're as good as dead vegetables. Because they don't have the vitamin in their life, you see. See them who have twice a day. See them who have once. So he's giving all that analysis. Now there's an old man, 95-year-old man, who's jumping in his seat, right in the last row. He's literally touching the roof. I want to share, and he's jumping like a spring. Now this professor is shocked. He's like, oh God, so much of energy. He's like the most energetic, right? And so much of light is emitting from everywhere from him. He's like, don't tell me you have it like 5 times a day. He looks like that. Oh God. Okay, come on. Young man, tell me. You're the youngest in the room, I can declare. I'm waiting for your answer, he says. How many times do you have? Old man says, once a year. Now the professor is shocked. Once a year? Do you want to know the punchline? So he says, once a year? And the man says, but tonight is the night, tonight is the night, tonight is the night. So, your present moment is not about the past, but about the future that you are living into. So, because that one night of the year happens to be this night, right now in the present moment, already everything is happening inside him. And he happens to be the most energetic in the world. If you didn't get the joke, don't miss the laugh. It's okay to miss the joke. Laugh, it's a joke. It's fine not to get the joke. Just laugh. Okay. Because when you laugh, your Ajna Chakra activates. Great. So that's how always a present moment is always given by a future moment that we are living into. But the future moment itself is filled with what? Completely filled with the past moment. Now you can imagine how much of damage is happening with us in our life. We are no more living a life of a life consciousness. We are just living a life of patterns, engrams, memories, which are gripping us from our past incompletions. When do I basically put in things into the future? When I am incomplete with the past. What do I mean by that? Any questions on this, by the way, before we move to the next one? Questions? Is this clear? Is this whole conversation clear?
Mm-hmm.
Past, present, future? Yes? Okay, good. Okay, so when I was born, when you were born, we were born like complete, right? This is a very important concept, so please listen. This concept is known as the Purnatva concept, very important, so please listen. When you and me were born like this, complete, whole, perfect where we are. Then what happened? Life started happening to us, right? From the moment I'm born, things are happening, life is happening. Until a certain stage, when I was still a certain stage, life was just moving and I had no particular interpretations or happiness or unhappiness about life, isn't it? Whenever I felt hungry as a small baby, I will cry. When I feel pain, I will cry. When I feel joy, I will just play. And I'll play with my own body, right? I'll put my leg into my mouth, I'll topple over, I'll be experimenting with my own body. I am complete unto myself. My whole life is a complete thing. It's a completion. It remains. I'm born with that way and I'm living that way. Now the moment I start growing up, what starts happening inside me? We spoke about this. Language. The moment language starts happening, I start defining life. Yes or no? The moment something happens which I don't like, I will start telling, I don't like this. I want mother, or I want this to happen. I don't like this food. I like that toy. All this we start telling, isn't it? There comes then situations when you are actually experiencing somewhere. You wrote that something is wrong here. Do you remember the guilt session? The first instance in life when you felt that something was really wrong with what was happening. When you say something is wrong with life, as a child you are saying something is wrong with me. Because life is not separate from you. For you, life is not different from you. So the moment you said that, what happened is the dent formed in the so-called complete energy that you were. The dent is formed by what, by the way? By your own mind. An interpretation of your own mind. The way you responded to one situation brought in a gap in this. Do we understand? Are you getting what I am saying? Are you with me so far? Yes? Now when this starts happening, what am I doing? The moment this has happened, I have started experiencing a dent in the whole and perfect completion that I have been till then. All situations, all pains, all suffering in life starts here. Now when this has happened, what do we think? That this has happened because of something and I have to fill this up. In order to fill this up, what do? I go out and try to do different things. I want to patch this up, move away from this experience by doing different other things. Sometimes I want to be friendly with someone. Sometimes I think I have to study more. I think I have to build a better building, better house, better car. But unfortunately, the more and more and more and more I go out, what am I experiencing? The more and more I feel this has remained intact. Everything else I am getting, I get success by the way, but I do not experience fulfillment. I do not get back the experience of that whole and perfect completeness. Are we getting this? I do not experience that. You getting this? Now when this is happening, whatever I try to do in life cannot fulfill this. Tell me why it cannot fulfill. Anything I do externally can never fill this. Why? Why do you think anything external cannot fill this? Because this was not formed from something external. This was formed from where? From internal, from your own mind. Do we understand? So the fulfillment can happen when? Only when I can do something internally and this can get restored. Only when I can go in, not when I can go out. Are we getting this? Only when you do that, you will be able to complete this. Every instance when I, like this, by the way, so many dents are made. As you are living your life, so many things are made. Every instance when I look in and when I get complete with something that has happened from the past, what am I doing? I'm not only filling this up, I'm actually erasing that piece from the past in the future. Do you understand? Bit by bit by bit, I'm putting back my past into the past. So what will happen in the future? In that future circle, I'm removing all the past. What will happen then? It becomes completely empty, open. And then you will see a new experience of life starts emerging for you. Do you have questions on this? Is this clear? Yes? But always, unfortunately, what do? In order to complete this thing, in order to restore fulfillment, what do? More and more we go out. We think, oh, I have to be more educated, I have to be more beautiful, I have to find a better person, I have to find a better job, this job is not good, I have to get a better boss. Always we are fixing situations and things outside us. Always we are looking at making a fix outside. Want to change things outside. Unfortunately, not realizing that this is not created from something outside. This is actually a creation of my own interpretation of things around me. Are we getting this? So when we get to that point where we realize that what needs to be done, the source lies within, that is the beginning of a breakthrough for you in your life. The beginning of you experiencing a whole new life. With me? There's a very beautiful Hindi saying which I love that saying personally. It says that, how many of us know Hindi here? Raise your hand if you understand Hindi. I'll of course translate it into English also so that everyone gets to know. I'll first tell it in Hindi. It says, Umr bar yun hi hum galtiyan karte rahe. Umr bar yun hi hum galtiyan karte rahe. Dhool chehre pe lagi thi hum aaina saaf karte rahe. Means, all my life I kept making this mistake. All my life I kept making this mistake. The dust was on my face, but I kept wiping the mirror. This is what we do. The source of suffering lies within. But we go out and we want to fix situations, manipulate people, change people outside. It is like I have a bruise on my cheek. I stand in front of a mirror. And the mirror is showing the bruise, right? And I'm like, oh, the mirror has a bruise on it. Oh God. And you put a band-aid on the mirror. Now next day you come and stand in front of the mirror, little 1 inch away. Will you see the bruise again? Of course you'll see the bruise again. And you'll say, oh, the mirror still has a bruise. And you'll put another band-aid. And you'll be wondering, how come I'm having the pain? How come I'm having the pain? And you're thinking the mirror is causing the pain. And you keep on putting band-aid all over the mirror. Now by the time you see the full mirror has a band-aid and the wound, by the way, has become deeper and deeper. Why? Because you never attended to it. And by the time you realize that you've actually put the band-aid in the wrong spot, where are you? Where are you by that time? Intensive care unit. Mercy hospitals, Yashoda hospital, Rama hospital, Krishna hospital, you're there. By the time I realize my band-aid is going away onto the mirror, I'm already in the intensive care unit of some ABCD hospital. Paying, and the doctor is building another house because of me. Because the hospital bill, I'm paying, no? And then it is too late. You don't have time either to remove the band-aid from the mirror, nor to put the band-aid back into the source which is you. Because by then you are almost gone. Or at least people around you are praying. Your sons, your daughters, your grandsons are, oh God, die soon, we don't have any more leave. Tomorrow boss is coming from US and this fellow is not dying, he's not leaving. Shit, he's killing me like this. Better you go fast. The doctor is not around, let me finish it off. Just remove the tube, yeah, he'll go off. You're already in that state. Now can you do anything about it? Tell me. Even if you want to live, there are people who are ready to kill you and they'll send you safely, happily. Don't worry about that. Right? So by the time we realize this, our life is done. But now with consciousness, with awareness, if you can get this, I will tell you, the journey of suffering will end for you. You will start experiencing a complete new life like how children experience. Each day will bring its own freshness. But that can be possible only if I can go back, and that's what you did in the first session. When you went back and wrote down everything that you wrote down in your life, you can see how much of that is still there in your present moment. How many of you can see? Lot of that past constraint, that fencing, that trauma, suffering is still there even now. It's still there when you see people, when you go through life. Now you have a chance. From today onwards, we'll be doing many processes. It's not a one-time process, where we will go inside, inch by inch by inch, and from inside we'll bring the whole turn of transformation. So this will still get complete by the end of the program, but it will get complete at the source. For the first time in your life, you will learn the art of putting the band-aid in the right spot. That's what you'll be doing for the rest of IA. Literally, you put the band-aid, you'll take it off the mirror, relieve the mirror of that burden, and put it in the right spot, and see healing happening within. The first phase of that is what's going to happen in this session today. In this session today, you will be actually, this is a first step of Purnatva Kriya. You have a second level also, an advanced level, which you will be doing in day after tomorrow, in end relationships, little after that, like in the next 2-3 days. But today is the beginning for that. And it's a very significant thing for you. It's very profound, because after this, you will acquire the art of not allowing incompletion of the past to sit in you. Meaning, you can actually develop the technology inside you where every moment you can be complete with the past and you can move on. We understand this? We have one more session on this when we do end relationships. Actually, a little of this had to be told then, but it's okay. It just happened. Each time, the sessions keep varying because Swamiji speaks through the teachers, so whatever is there for the group to come, it will come out. But we'll do that. There's a little bit more left which I won't tell today. We'll do it in the end relationship session. This much is enough for today's session. Right? So today's session, what we'll be doing is, we'll actually be reliving the whole thing by bringing out whatever was the incompletion that was there for us, now with conscious awareness. Literally in the breathing space of the master, when you're doing this process, you will see tremendous healing happening. You will see that past, whatever were the constraints sitting here, the fences will start dropping, will start dissolving. Ready? Yes? So before that, we'll first have to make a oath again. The oath is, it's like a promise, a commitment, an oath you're giving, that whatever you listen in the room, whenever people are sharing, whatever you listen, it's going to be confidential. You're not going to share it with anyone, anywhere outside this room. Shall we do that? Because there will be so many things. You'll have somebody just share with you, you know, I murdered my wife. Now you go, you murdered your wife? Oh God, and tomorrow you can't go and put it in the newspaper. Anything that people share, there'll be many things. Anything can happen, human beings like that. You understand? So even if somebody says, you know what, I molested my daughter, that's all, that's it, you will forget it there. There is no question of carrying it outside the room. And by the way, this commitment goes for all sessions, even Akashic readings. When Swamiji tells somebody something, he will tell someone, you know, you were a murderer in your last life, you killed four ladies. Now you can't go out and do the publicity. This fellow was a murderer last time. Or if Swamiji says, you know, you were an angel, you were living with some such and such goddess, you can't go out again and tell the same person, hey, that's so cool, you were an angel. No. Anything that's discussed here cannot be revealed or rediscussed in any other situation outside of the room. Is this clear? Yes. Unless you're doing it for a constructive purpose, meaning somebody had some addiction, right? And in the sessions, through inner awakening, they got out of it. Now, if you're helping some drug addict out there in your life, you can tell. That doesn't mean you'll give the full postal address, email ID, name, photograph. No. You can just mention that one person who was an addict in when I was doing the program actually came out of it. So that way the program is very powerful. Constructively, to that extent, you can share. If you know, it will help another person connect with the program and with Swamiji. Is this clear? Always for any other purposes, you cannot use this information, misuse this information, abuse this information. Do we understand? And you're giving this promise directly to Swamiji. So don't play with that promise. Take it seriously. And we are one family. It's like one unit. If you don't create the space of trust, tell me how will you break in the program? This is the place where you can leave everything here and go forever. And we should provide that space to one another. Is this clear? So let's first sit straight and make this sankalpa, make this intention and this oath. level of Purnotpatiya is acknowledging whatever has happened in your life and being able to share it outside of you. There will be so many things in your life which you would have never wanted to tell another person. So many things. Things which you think are the worst things that can happen. Somebody molested me, I molested someone, I kicked someone, I beat someone, I abused someone, someone abused me. You name it and we have people who have faced it. Like so many different kinds. You name it and we have faced it. You know, we have seen people going through it. But no matter what it is, now is the time for you to get that who you are is none of that. The real capital U, remember the capital U I was speaking about, is actually beyond all of this. All of this is only that which is not you. Remember, the whole inner awakening is what? Removing everything that is not you from you. And this is the first step to removing that. So in today's process, what you will be sitting is, what you will be doing is, you will be sitting with a partner. So quickly, you can take any partner. If you are not comfortable with people of your own group, I would actually ask you to take a person you have not interacted much with in the program. You can sit with any language. That's the good news. You need not sit only with Spanish, Spanish, French, French. French, Spanish can sit, Chinese, Tamil can sit. Because irrespective of language, you can pair up for this exercise. So this is what will happen. Two of you, you will take a partner and one of you, one will be, let us say Nitya, one will be Ananda. So select who is Nitya, who is Ananda. After that, the Nityas will start sharing their whole story to the Anandas. Do we get this? No censoring, no having conditions, oh this part I won't share, this line I will share, that I will not share. No. It is, remember, you are directly telling it to Swamiji. The person listening to you is Swamiji. So I don't think you want to hide anything from Swamiji, right? Everything that has happened, whether you consider it good, bad, worst, whatever that is, share it with the person you are sitting with. Completely, fully. You have to live it. So as you are sharing, experience that is happening with you. If you have to cry, cry. If you feel angry, express it. Don't punch the opposite person. Save them. You can come to me if you have that kind of anger. I'll do whatever has to be done. But apart from that, let your emotions come out. If you feel like crying, just cry. Now remember that we are one unit. We have already established that in the room. So you need not feel embarrassed about, oh God, how do I express? Just express. Is this clear? So the person who's talking will talk fully. You will live the incident as if it is happening now with you. Now the person who's listening has to become a wall. What do I mean by that? You will just sit looking at the person. By the way, has to become a wall does not mean you'll close your eyes. No. No saying I'll meditate and listen. No. No sleeping at all. Don't do that. You will have to keep your eyes open. You will have to look at them, but you cannot agree, disagree, nod, empathize. Oh, even I had the same thing. No. No hugging. No doing anything. Will a wall hug you? Tell me if I'm going and standing in front of a wall and saying, you know what? My husband is so dirty. He fought with me. Wall will say, yes, yes, yes. My husband is also like that. No, it doesn't say. So you cannot say anything to the person who's sharing. You'll have to just sit like this. Look into their eyes and that's all. Remain like a stone. Is this clear? So you will not do anything. Even if that person is collapsing and fainting, you don't do anything. We are there. We come around, we'll do something about it. You don't say, oh, come on, sleep in my lap and take. No. No sympathizing, no empathizing, no nodding, no agreeing, no disagreeing, no nothing. Last thing you want to do is advice. This is what life is all about. No. You will not talk. Walls don't talk. Is this clear? Clear? So the person who's listening has a bigger job than the person who's talking. Because you will see, suddenly your expression will start. Correct, correct. He'll be crying and you'll be doing this. Like how Swamiji was saying, no, you will have to just be like a rock. Okay? Do we get this? But you don't have a choice of closing your eyes. I'm meditating, someone told me. No, you can't meditate. Meditate when we ask you to, not in this process. No meditating, no sleeping, no lying down. Nothing. Sitting and looking at them, that's all. Okay? Person who's sharing, fully share everything. Every single thing. Even the dirtiest things you think has happened in your life, just put it out. Remember, you are actually literally speaking it into Swamiji's ears, physically. Is this clear? Now once you finished, you have to switch. The person who was listening, the Ananda will become the Nitya. Then they will start sharing. Then the Nitya has to do what? Be a wall. You have to sit like a stone and you have to listen. Now, you will have to repeat your story with many people in the room till you get to a point where you are completely disconnected with your story. What do I mean by that? The moment I think of my life story, I will have something here, na? Something which will hold me like this. Ah, pain. Or I'll have tears. Or I'll feel, no, I don't want to think of that. I want to go and have a cup of coffee. All of those things which put you away from your life, which give you the sensation of pain, which have some kind of an impact on you. Till that goes away, you will have to share with people in the room. Even if it means 300 times, you have to share. Don't worry about 300 people, I'll get them for you. Don't worry about that. Do you understand this? So you'll have to keep on repeating the story till you have disassociated, disconnected with it. Will that happen? Yes, it will happen. Somewhere it will happen. 5th time, 10th time, 20th time, I don't know. Depends upon how much you are carrying your story. Depends upon your attachment to your story. It depends. But minimum every person should do. Like somebody was saying, I didn't have anything much to write. Even then, every person in the room has to do it at least 3 times with 3 people in the room. Are we clear on this? Yes.
You say language is not a barrier.
It is not. Because anyway, the other person is a stone, so it doesn't matter. So you can sit with a chameleon, not at all a problem. So if you feel, I have a story, oh God, which nobody else in the world has, sit with a person who doesn't know your language, simple. Then it's easy actually for you to become a stone when you don't know the end, anyway you don't understand. But don't go by the facial expression, okay, they are crying, are you, let me give a handkerchief, no. I am there, I will give handkerchief.
I wanted to recall my childhood, so I wrote in Swedish. Which nobody would be able to understand.
No problem. Nobody needs to understand. You need to come out of it. So any language you can speak, and you can speak to person in any language. Is this clear? Guys, say yes, say no. How can you just go off into your own words and... Guys, is this clear? Listen. Family group is having a gala time. Listen. Is this clear? Any other questions on this? Any other questions on this should either have a yes or a no as an answer. Any other questions?
No.
Clear? So quickly take pairs. Just choose a partner. As I said, anyone in the room can be a partner. Not necessarily the person who is next to you. So just go around, take anyone. For this you can sit with women also. Men and women can sit. Just take one partner. Even if they understand, it is fine. They don't understand, also it's fine. Either race is fine. But listen up, it's important to share every single thing of your life. Guys, listen up. Listen up. Okay, form your teams, then again I'll repeat this. Just quickly take a partner. Sit down somewhere in the room. Let's do this in the next 1 minute. Quickly take a partner. Listen, please listen. You will share everything from your life, even if you didn't write in that book. While sharing, I forgot to write in the book, forget that thing. Book is not so important, sharing is important. If you didn't write, also share. If you wrote, definitely share, okay? It's your life, so you don't need a manual for your life, do you? You just need to get in, the whole life will come like this, na? So just share. Every single thing which has happened in your life, you got to share. Remember, you promised Swamiji. Did you promise or not?
Yes.
Yes. What did you promise? I'll be honest. I'll be authentic. I will not hide anything. I will do exactly the way I'm told. Okay? So you'll be sharing and suddenly you're like, chi. This one I went and slapped someone and robbed someone. I don't want to tell this. No. Don't be judgmental. Just share even the dirtiest things you have done or somebody has done to you. Do you understand this? Yes. I know, as I said, this will be challenging. And I know you're big enough to deal with this. And you should know the master is with you. Listen, guys, I know it's challenging. I know for some of you it's already so difficult. But please acknowledge the bigness that you are. You are bigger than your circumstances. Your tiny, mini, wormy, insecty circumstances cannot. How many more years and lifetimes you want your life to be like this, tell me? Haven't you given enough room to your mind? You have lived with your mind for so many years. Live with the master for 15 days, my request. Though it is challenging, I am requesting you, please, please, please listen to what he is saying and do it. I know how it is for you, star. I experience it. I have gone through this myself. I promise you, what you will get at the end of it is something which you will love. I just want you to just a little bit of that surrender is needed, and I know you will do it. So no matter how difficult it is, I want you to go through this, guys, authentically, honestly. Everything should come out. You cannot censor anything. You cannot hide anything. Even the worstest things which you yourself have forgotten, dig them out, bring them out. Let all the skeletons come out of the basket today. Is this clear? Yes? And the person who's listening, strict instruction. You're just a wall, remember. For how much ever time. No reactions. Okay, you have a question, yes?
I'm a little confused. Exactly what is this shape? Because
Exactly
what is this? Are we shape?
You have to tell your whole life. From where it began, how you remember, all of it. And you tell the entire unpleasant bent of your life. That's what you've
written. So what were you reading? What we wrote?
Yes. What you wrote, and as you're sharing what you wrote, you'll be reading it out. If you remember other things, that also you can include. Clear? Everything about your life, you're presenting it to a wall. That's all you're doing right now. Clear? Shall we any other questions? Any other questions? You'll have a very different music in this meditation. By the way, this is a meditation process. People have asked me, why that music? Why can't we remove it? We cannot remove it. I'll tell you the significance of that later. You will have to do it with that background only. Okay?